speaker, Dr. Kathirvel Subramaniam from USA. His topic is on ultrasound, our sixth sense, beyond nerve blocks.
My name is Dr. Subramaniam. I come from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. It was great thoughts from Abhijit, and I truly miss Piyush, who was my beloved junior. Myself, Shiv, Abhijit were all in Ames during 1990s. It was fun time. He never said no to me in my entire residency. I was senior resident, he was junior resident. He never said no. We lost in touch for a few years, and we met back in Jipmer with Shiv a few years back. And I asked him for a project to be done together. Again, I never heard no. So he completed the project and then sent me the email to me before I even started working on it. So that much energy. And then I had different things. So I truly miss him, just like TAS members. With that, we should fulfill his aims, and that's what we should work on. And I know one of these lovable subject is ultrasound. I think it's important we carry on with this topic. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. So before starting, I want to give, last night after the dance floor, I saw Surinder, and he told me, you are going to be the opening batsman tomorrow. So I think he is the Dhoni of the Super Kings, and your Chennai team is real Super Kings, and you are champions. And it's you set a very high bar for next team from Lucknow. So so I will start talking. So the ultrasound, sixth sense for anesthesiologist. I have some disclosures for my colleagues whom I took some images from. So when you set up an ultrasound service in your hospital, you have to understand what are the priorities in your system. So whatever I am going to talk about is what I have done in our system. So that may not completely applicable to your system. So you may be doing more or less, but the universal to all ultrasound programs is cardiac and lung ultrasound. So rest of the systems, how much you do depends on. So that's Piyush when I met him in Delhi last time. So that's my POCUS partners from Pittsburgh, Christopher Short and Michael Boyson. This is a story of loving husband and wife to start with. I have a 62-year-old man with sudden onset chest pain, admitted to cardiac care unit. Cardiac catheterization showed triple vessel disease. He is posted for urgent CABG. I saw him in preoperative holding area. I was the cardiac anesthesia fellow at that time. Family was his by side, and the attending anesthesiologist and myself explained the risks and benefits to the family and trying to take the patient to the operating room. So while taking her husband to the operating room, the wife collapsed on the floor. So immediately the CPR was done. She was put on the stretcher and she revived. And cardiac anesthesiologist immediately took the echocardiography probe and put on the wife and checked. And this is what he has seen. This is the husband's echo for comparison, I put it. And this is the wife's echo. It looks pretty much similar, is that right? So that is so loving husbands, even their echo picture in stress looks similar. But the pathology is different. So you have to understand that the echo should be interpreted on the background of clinical information. So echo should not be interpreted by itself. So she, after a few days, her stress got relieved. She got a repeat echo. So we did a catheterization on her, which was totally negative. So what's the diagnosis? It's a stress-induced cardiomyopathy. So you have apical hypokinesis, which can be because of ischemic heart disease, or it could be related to sympathetic-induced cardiomyopathy. The husband had a true cardiac disease, and the wife had a stress-induced cardiomyopathy. So we fixed both of them. And then they happily lived ever after, okay? So what did ultrasound do to us? The proceduralist, we were proceduralists in anesthesia. So we do conduct anesthesia, we put lines in, we do all these things, but it made us better proceduralists, okay? In addition to proceduralists, it also made us diagnosticians. So that's what the anesthesiologist did on the bedside. He diagnosed stress-induced cardiomyopathy. Without ultrasound, he would not have done that. He would have transferred the patient to ICU and did additional procedures. So ultrasound can be used head to foot. As I told you, you have to set your priorities to learn. So that priority is putting lines in, how to use ultrasound for line placement. Number two, how to use ultrasound for regional anesthesia. Number three, cardiac ultrasound. Number four is lung ultrasound. Everything else is handy. It comes handy in situations. But I will tell you some situations like that. So first I will talk about, I will not go into regional anesthesia or line placement, but I'll talk about echocardiography. What are the components of perioperative echocardiography? It's an intraoperative TEE has well-proven benefit for cardiac surgery. I'm not going to talk about it. The audience is not cardiac anesthesia. So preoperative TTE, yesterday Veda Bala was discussing about what is the role of echocardiogram in a preoperative period. We'll touch base on that. But the definite role is when the patient gets hemodynamic collapse in the perioperative period, either TTE or TEE can be used to diagnose the problem. That is the most important application. The questionable benefit is whether the preoperative TTE is useful or not, but the intraoperative TEE for cardiac surgery is definitely useful. So, come on, rescue TTE or rescue TEE, which one you will do? Again, it depends on the clinical situations. So now let me tell you, 45-year-old healthy with lone atrial fibrillation. She underwent EP ablation procedure of atrial fibrillation, very low blood pressure, non-responsive to fluids in the recovery room. Anesthesiologist arrived at the scene. So he saw this. As soon as he put the subcostal images, he saw there is definite fluid around the heart. So you can see this is the myocardium, that's the occlusency, that's the fluid around the arch. This is a bleeding into the pericardium. So what should you do? Ansuman told you ABCs yesterday, you need to do that because the patient is relatively stable. You cannot get excited and do abnormal things, put a catheter right there and then cause more problems without monitoring. So basically you keep cool You inform the interventional radiology, patient taken back to the EP laboratory, pericardial catheter was inserted under fluoroscopy, and patient got better immediately. Now, let me tell you patient B, a 49-year-old woman, underwent Nissen fundoplication. She was in the recovery room with low blood pressure. It was attributed to AC inhibitor, which she takes in the morning. So sudden onset of severe hypotension followed by pulseless electrical activity. This is not a situation to do TTE. This is a situation to intubate the patient and do TEE. So that's what it was done. So you can see this is the blood accumulated around the pericardium, compressing on the right ventricle. This is the interventricular septum and the left ventricle. So this is a different pericardial tamponade from the other case. So when to use TEE, TTE for rescue, it depends on the clinical situation. Preoperative evaluation, when to request, what is the decision-making tree, what are the limitations, who can do TTE. So first, let me tell you, routine preoperative echocardiography for high-risk surgery is not indicated without patient's evaluation. Yield is high, your results will be positive when there is a high index of suspicion for cardiac disease. When will that happen? So you have cardiac symptoms, you have signs like murmur. Murmur is, so people say stethoscope will be replaced by echocardiogram. It will never. Echocardiogram, you have to auscultate to request the echocardiogram. You cannot just replace it. So the functional status cannot be determined. But these are all some of the indications. So never had a cardiac test, but patient has symptoms. Abnormal cardiac investigations, but never followed up. Known cardiac disease, but with a recent deterioration. So previous perioperative cardiac complications. These are all some of the indications for requesting echo, not all patients. So decision tree, I will tell you some of the scenarios. Scenario one, patient A. So here is an 82-year-old patient with a IM nailing for femur found to have significant echocardiographic finding like aortic stenosis. If you hear murmur, the patient may have nothing, or you can have a severe aortic stenosis. If the patient is functionally inactive, they may not tell about symptoms. So this patient was referred to cardiology. With that much severe stenosis, you don't want to take the patient to the OR. You may need some kind of intervention before taking the patient to the OR. Next. Scenario one, but the patient B. So 72-year-old coal miner, hip surgery on oxygen, preoperative consult were requested for anesthesia, occasional shortness of breath, not very active man. Again, murmur, TTE done by anesthesiologist. So here is the finding here. So you can see that is the apical four-chamber view, and this is the right ventricle, this is the right atrium, left ventricle, left atrium. You can see the right ventricle is bigger than the left ventricle. So this patient is having pulmonary hypertension, secondary to that coal mining lung, and then causing right ventricular dysfunction. This cannot be determined even without echocardiogram. So echocardiogram is useful when you do it in the right patient. So scenario two. So scenario one, require intervention before surgery, before taking the patient, pulmonary hypertension, aortic stenosis, you need to get to the cardiologist before getting the patient to the OR. Scenario two, look at this, 65-year-old man, he's a peripheral vascular disease for lower extremity vascularization. History of CAD, he had stents, low EF to start with, echo 2 years back, recent increase in symptoms, so I did echo TTE in holding area by anesthesia. And this is what I find. This is a long axis view, this is the aortic valve, this is the left side of the heart, and you see mitral regurgitation jet. So that mitral regurgitation, I do not know whether it's new or old, but the patient has cold leg. So you want to assess the urgency of the situation and how severe the condition is, okay? So this patient's mitral regurgitation is not fatal unless it is acute. I assume this patient has a chronic coronary artery disease with a chronic MR. There may be increased MR now because of stress, but this patient does not require cardiac consult. You want to get this patient to the OR. What does anesthesia does to afterload? It decreases afterload. So the MR, in fact, may improve under anesthesia unless you increase your blood pressure. So I took the patient to the surgery without problem. So what did I do? The sum of the step-up management. You have positive finding, you need to change your management. That is called step-up management. So you get the drips on the board, you get monitoring on the board, arterial line, CVP. You plan for an ICU admission, and then you ask for post-operative cardiac consultation. These are all some of the step-up management. Now, let us take scenario three. 78-year-old man with a systolic murmur needs hip surgery, elective surgery, echo request from colleague to make sure there is no aortic stenosis in the holding area. Sound. Look at the aortic valve, how nicely it's opening. So there is no positive finding, that murmur has no significance. Okay. Now what will you do? Take the patient to the OR. Not only take the patient to the OR, don't put arterial line, don't ask for cardiac consult. These are all downsizing your management. That means you are step down your therapy. So even the echo findings are going to be negative, it's going to help in your management because you are avoiding unnecessary morbidity by putting lines and other things. So that is what. See, UPMC experience, we started echocardiography service, transthoracic echo for preoperative for 2017. Three anesthesiologists trained ourselves in echocardiogram, transthoracic echo. We had 10 years of experience in transesophageal echo. So reporting first 101 TTEs. So this is what the consult was given for. We had 50 patients for preoperative evaluation, 46 for hemodynamic instability, and 5 patients we used TTE for monitoring because you have a neurosurgery, you can't put the probe in. So we monitored with TTE during the intraoperative period. So these are all the findings. So you see the primary finding is hypovolemia. Second important finding was left ventricular dysfunction. Third interesting finding was hyperdynamicity from vasoplegia and sepsis. So these three predominant pictures. So if you know how to evaluate for volume status, if you know how to evaluate for left ventricular dysfunction, if you know how to evaluate for vasoplegia, your echocardiography is covered more or less. All right. So that is what you need to focus on. So modification of patient management, it does modify your therapy. So echocardiogram, people can say, looking at the studies, it doesn't change the outcome. Okay, but it does change your management perioperatively and changes your perioperative anesthesia-related outcome. It may not change the outcome because there are surgical outcomes, there are infective outcomes, there are other outcomes you cannot change, but you can definitely change, which will not be documented in the papers which you read. So just saying, looking at the paper, echocardiography is not useful, that is not correct. So, going to the limitations, CAD, you can't use echocardiography to diagnose CAD. You need to do a stress echocardiography or coronary catheterization. If somebody is telling, so this is a consult I got, patient had stents, coming for back surgery, stopped Plavix and aspirin in the 7 days before, go and evaluate the heart. Okay, so I'm not going to diagnose stress-induced ischemia in that patient, okay? So, but it will be helpful to know basal function is normal. You take the patient to the OR, he collapses. If the heart dilates, that means you are causing ischemia. So, but again, the limitation is you don't use a resting echocardiogram to diagnose CAD. That is a limitation. So education requirements, I'm going to put three different parts. One is a focused echocardiogram, limited and comprehensive, these three. Comprehensive echocardiogram is nothing but what cardiologist does. We don't want to get there. You want a left atrial volume calculation. So you want to know whether the cardiomyopathy is because of what is the concomitant diseases like amyloidosis, or you don't want to get there, but these two you should know. Focused cardiography is nothing but there are three levels. These are all the things you want to look at focused cardiography, four Vs. Volume status, ventricles, valves, and vasoplegia. So these four things you should know how to evaluate. That is focus. Everybody in this room should know how to look for it. So this doesn't need any qualifications. And as an anesthesiologist, everybody should know. So what is limited echocardiography? Limited echocardiography is the one which I do for preoperative evaluations. For example, a patient comes for diagnosis of aortic stenosis, diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension. That needs little more expertise, little more quantitative echocardiogram. There you want to consult a cardiac anesthesiologist, or you go and test yourself, read yourself more about it, practice yourself more about it. Then you can do. So quantitative echocardiography like ejection fraction, diastolic function, LA pressure, PA pressure, RV function, TAPSE, all these things kind of limited TTE. That is what done for preoperative evaluations. That needs some more training. So I suggest you learn that 4 Vs and utilize in your practice when the patient is not doing well. That is the first step. So what is the difference between anesthesia TTE and cardiology TTE? AIM, it's a very goal-directed examination, but the cardiology diagnosis, what is the etiology? Performance, I do the echo myself, not the sonographer. Interpretation, I do myself, with the background of acute hemodynamic management, but there, they do the long-term management. That is the difference between cardiology. Availability, I am available round the clock if the expertise is available, only daytime. Quantitative methods, very limited quantitative methods in anesthesia, cardiology, extensive quantitative. Other focus, I can do integrated cardiac focus and lung focus. I'll tell you one example. So, but the cardiologists do only integrated thoracic ultrasound. It's a 45-year-old woman, morbid obesity, known ischemic cardiomyopathy, 10 to 15%, history of previous intubations, tracheal stenosis, tracheal dilatation under general anesthesia. Procedure completed, extubation done. Post-procedure was maintaining saturations on oxygen, but visibly on distress. So the thoracic surgeon is on the table telling me, take the patient back to the OR. I may look into the trachea again because of the airway edema, okay? The cardiologist on the side looking at the echo saying there is nothing I found in the abnormal in the heart because the heart is already 10 to 15%. What are you going to see abnormality more than that? So I was trying to manage the airway. So what do? Call for help. When you need hands, call for help. So I call my colleague who can do the echocardiogram or ultrasound, asked him to do one particular thing, which is lung ultrasound. Okay? So when we did the lung ultrasound, this is what I found. So what is this? Yesterday, POCUS workshop, people attended? B lines. So this patient is in pulmonary edema. I don't know the reason for pulmonary edema. He is narrow airway. He may have, you know, negative pressure pulmonary edema, or it because of cardiac condition, but the diagnosis is clear. So it's pulmonary edema. It's a lung-induced respiratory distress, not otherwise. So that is how we integrate lung ultrasound and cardiac ultrasound, unlike cardiologists. The limitation, I hear from all the colleagues in India, there is a limitation that the ultrasound machine will be purchased and put it in one place and other things. What we have to do for that, you need to come up with the data, and then you need to convince your ISA, you need to convince with political persons to release that for anesthesiologists. We don't do abnormal things, so we need to get that. So that's the limitation three. So the lung ultrasound is a game changer. So I think I will show some pictures before I leave. So this is a patient I was trying to put femoral arterial line with 2 blind attempts I was not able to get, and I did a point of care ultrasound and found a big thrombus in the femoral vein, okay? So then this patient came for lung transplantation. I went ahead and did the TEE and found a clot in the pulmonary artery too. So point of care ultrasound really, really helps DVT management in some patients in the operating room. So the case canceled, patient put on Coumadin, came back weeks later with a clear pulmonary artery on the CT scan, and we did a lung transplant again. So abdominal ultrasound. So people say you want to do a abdominal focus. When will you do that? I will tell you 2 examples before I leave. This is a patient who had a AAA endovascular repair and come to the holding a recovery room, and he was collapsing. So we did an examination of the abdomen with ultrasound and found fluid in the Morrison pouch. So that means take back the patient. This is one instance. I used abdominal ultrasound very limited in my setup. ER people use it. Intensive care guys use it, but my utility is very limited. The other patient I used is a young patient, came with a splenic perihapsular hematoma, and then they were observing him in the floor. And then he came for a leg fracture fixation, but his hemoglobin dropped from the night to the morning. So, and then he was not looking good. by visibly. So we went ahead and did echocardiogram and also the abdominal focus and found a splenic bleed. So the splenic bleed is between the spleen and the kidney. This is a simulation picture. I don't have the picture of that particular patient. So those are all the abdominal examinations. We love cricket in Pittsburgh too. So we play cricket there. Chennai Super Kings, thank you. So I thank TAS organization. Chennai TAS is really a Chennai Super Kings. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kathirvel.